So, ma'am, 11 o'clock is going on. Before we ask you formally to come, everybody who is on as the participant all know about the ma'am. She needs for no further introduction. As we say, sirf naam hi kaafi hai. Pinky Anand means everybody. And it's always an Anand to hear Pinky Anand. We cannot have a more enriching session when Pinky Anand is there. And all in our this session, we have students as well as budding lawyers and the lawyers who have reasonable practice and a very good practice. So the persons who are participating in the session either are having on the criminal law or the criminal procedure, that is appellate authority as well as the revisional side, either 1D view or 2D view. After your insightful session, I'm quite sure that they will have a 3D view. They cannot have better than that. And more interesting part would be once there is a 3D view, nobody is going to wear the goggles for a 3D movie until unless they for that they actually require. But for your session, your speaking itself is enough. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you. Ma'am, you have to unmute yourself.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank
Okay,
you.
it's done. Right.
Yeah.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Vikasji. And I think this is a one occasion which we must cherish. Vikas has been able to, in this series of Beyond Law CLC, I think take up issues of interest. I think it is a time of knowledge. We have learned to deal with the virtual world. We have to learn to occupy ourselves. We have to learn to educate ourselves. We have to learn to discipline ourselves. And I think we have to take this opportunity in this fashion to progress further with our way of life and with our professional life. So what better way than to actually have these kind of series where not only, sorry, are we talking to you, some of us. I know you had a scintillating lecture yesterday, and most of you must have enjoyed it and learned from that. I don't think it is only a learning for you, it is also a learning for us or a relearning for us. So we start all over again. We look at the issues which are confronting us. We look at the issues which confront young lawyers such as yourselves, law students, the dilemmas, and we try to address those to the best of our abilities and then to interact with each other to see how we can improve the situation of law. Because law is an evolving process. Law is not stagnant and law continues to always evolve. And I might say, in fact, that a criminal law itself is an extremely complex series of issues and it has to resolve itself in various directions. I think in India, we have been very consistent with the fact that the rule of law means that there must be availability of justice for all. And availability of justice, availability of rule of law, availability of remedy is something that we as Indians are proud of. And we should be proud of. But at the same time, there has to be an end to litigation. So we have to look at some of these issues to go further on how we should progress so that we can provide the rule of law while at the same time limiting to some extent the jurisdictions so that there must be a finality to issues and we must resolve ourselves. While we say this, I must also mention one other issue which we came across in some of the discussions, which is to say what is going to be the kind of litigation that we are going to have in the future. Is it going to be the same as pre-COVID-19 or is it going to be something that in fact develops itself into another direction? Is there going to be less litigation? Is there going to be higher litigation? Is the litigation going to be of the same pattern on the same subject or are we going to see a different kind of litigation? I think since we are talking about criminal law today, we could well believe that there will not be a drastic change in criminal law litigation because criminal law has remained somewhat similar during the course of time. And even though law evolves itself, the criminal litigation itself will possibly continue in the same broad fashion. There might be differences in commercial litigation and civil litigation. We might have more cases of force majeure. We might have cases of payment of laborers. You might have health issues. You might have security issues. But broadly, as far as the criminal litigation is concerned, it would continue with the same kind of process as it has in the past. So with this backdrop, let me start with the subject that I have chosen And this was, the subject was chosen with the consultation with Vikas and with his team people, who thought that the subject of criminal revision, inherent powers of courts, appeals, and the interplay between these three is something which is extremely interesting and evolving. And students and lawyers would like to know more about that. That is why the subject of criminal appeal versus revisional jurisdiction versus inherent powers. And at the outset, I will say that it is an extremely broad field. So while I have gone into some of the aspects, I will not be able to cover each of them in as much detail as we should, because it needs to be split up into various other sessions possibly. So I have tried to deal broadly with the aspect of the differences between appeal and revision, the question of revisional powers, in particular the revision against interlocutory orders, and you'll find the expression intermediate orders, and finally, in a broad way, the inherent powers of the court and the interplay between revisional jurisdiction and 482 CRPC, as the inherent powers are called within the Code of Criminal Procedure Code. So straight away, we will come to the aspect of availability of remedy and the various remedies under the CRPC. We basically have the basic principle of how no one should be left without any remedy. And that is how the provisions of appeal, review, revision facilitate and maintain judicial propriety by ensuring that no individual is wronged by an error of a court. Because one of the reasons behind law's birth was to preserve the right of the parties. The existence of law becomes worthless when the judgment of a lawsuit is erroneous. In situations where people are wronged, and criminal law, incidentally, really infringes on the liberty of the individual, when people are wronged, they take the shelter of law. But when law fails to provide a remedy or the shelter, the person becomes helpless and loses his trust in law. It is therefore a common principle that the law should not be mistaken. You should have a remedy to appeal, revise, modify, reverse. And it is in this backdrop that the provisions of appeal, review, and revision were born. Of course, not only in criminal jurisdiction, but also in civil jurisdiction. There is no definition of word appeal. Let us come to some broad frameworks of where we possibly might need to develop ourselves a little more on jurisprudence. So if you look at the statute and you look at the various provisions, for example, appeal is provided in various sections of the CRPC under chapter 29, between 372, section 372 to 394. But appeal itself is not defined. Similarly, where revision appears, starting from 397 onwards to 401 CRPC, you again have no real definition of revision. So it has been left to interpretation to evolve a definition of appeal and to define the contours of appeal and revision. In this backdrop, straight away, the basic difference between appeal and revision is that an appeal is a statutory right. Now, as I mentioned earlier, you have between 372 to 394, you have a right of appeal against conviction, you have a right of appeal against acquittal, you have a right of appeal against orders demanding security or peace, and these stretch across each of these provisions of 372 to 394. But is it that a statutory right means that all rights are there? No. Appeal itself is a right as a statutory right within the parameters of statute. And therefore, sometimes it is said that there is no vested right to appeal, though ultimately I must say that the distinctive point for lawyers is that a right of appeal is a vested right, whereas a right of revision is a discretionary right. Who can appeal? You have various provisions for appeal as far as the state government has been concerned, to direct the public prosecutor to appeal against a sentence on the ground of inadequacy. You have the right to appeal against the acquittal against the inadequate sentence by the complainant. And in fact, you have the various other rights of appeals as they are provided under these sections, as I mentioned to you earlier. But I would like to go further on the aspect of the powers of criminal appeal and revisional jurisdiction, where the powers lie. As we said, right of appeal is a statutory right within the sections of 372 to 394. Is it the same? Can you do? Can the court, high court, or the sessions court apply the same principles as they apply in the case of appeal to a revision? Here, I will quote to you the Supreme Court in Lakshman Das versus Santokh Singh, which says an appeal is a continuation of a suit or proceedings where the entire proceedings are again left open for consideration by the appellate authorities, which has the power to review the entire evidence, subject, of course, to the prescribed statutory limitations. But in the case of revision, powers the revision authority may have, it has no power to reassess and reappreciate the evidence unless the statute expressly confers upon it that power. That limitation is implicit in the concept of revision. Similarly, in Harishankar, again, in 63, the Supreme Court says, a right of appeal carries with it a right of rehearing on law as well as fact, unless the statute conferring the right of appeal limits the rehearing in some way, as we find has been done in second appeals arising out of the court of CPC. The power to hear a revision is generally given as the superior court so that it may satisfy itself that a particular case has been decided according to law. In state of Kerala, the Supreme Court observes, when the legislature confers a right of appeal in one case and a discretionary remedy of revision in another, it must be deemed to have created two jurisdictions, different in scope and content. When it introduced the familiar concepts of appeal and revision, it is also reasonable to assume that the well-known distinction between these two jurisdictions was also accepted by the legislature. There is an essential distinction between an appeal and a revision. The distinction is based on differences implicit in the set two expressions. An appeal is a continuation of the proceedings. To effect the same proceedings are before the appellate authority, and it has power to review the evidence subject to the statutory limitations prescribed. But in the case of a revision, whatever powers a revision authority may or may not have, it has not the power to review the evidence unless the statute expressly confers on it that power. That limitation is implicit in the concept of revision. And I think with this kind of backdrop, we see that there are ultimately tremendous differences between the scope of appeal and revision. Whereas an appeal requires and can provide for a rehearing, a revision has discretionary powers and is not able to provide for a rehearing, but really it is dealing with gross miscarriage of justice, abuse of powers, and situations where there is a glaring defect, where the court calls for itself the powers under 397 and 2401, whether it is the High Court or the Sessions Court. I was actually going to see the table of major differences, and I will basically just very briefly show you this chart, which points out the differences between appeal and revision. I thought it was somewhat constructive, and I will basically just briefly...
You can send it on WhatsApp. I will ask my team to post it on the chat box.
Yes, I'll do so.
Just ask your team to send me the WhatsApp. Yeah. I can put it on the chat box.
I will just do it straight away. So, if I may just take a minute to do that.
Not an issue. Myself, so you already referenced our team is also posting, and some other lawyers also are posting the judgments which you are citing on the chat box.
That's so nice of them, because I think that serves its own purpose, and we can actually see. And I, as I said, my when I look at this issue of criminal jurisdictions, I find that there is a lot of overlap, a lot of conflict, and a lot of confusion as to what the scope of jurisdictions is. Therefore, it is essential not only to evaluate what we have ahead of us, but to ensure that we can bring an end to this conflict. We bring an end to what kind of jurisdiction there should be in respect of appeal, revision, and inherent powers. There has been, I think this time again, this was one of the reasons I chose this subject, is because I felt that we could actually examine unto ourselves as to where we have come, and we don't need to necessarily then go backwards when issues have been decided, when courts have decided the jurisdictional powers and availability of remedies to lawyers and to litigants, rather to litigants and therefore to lawyers. So the points of differences I was just pointing out, of course, the first is the legal provisions, 372 to 394, revision between 397 to 405, the jurisdiction exercised by the court in appeal, appellate jurisdiction, revision, divisional jurisdiction, legal rights, appeal is a statutory right, whereas a divisional jurisdiction is the discretion of the court. Which courts can exercise powers of appeal and revision? So therefore, in appeal, Superior Court, High Court and Sessions Court, Revision, High Court and Sessions Court, power of interference. I think that is an area of immense consideration. There is unrestricted power in appeal as far as power of interference of the court is concerned. In the case of revision, it is limited and restricted. The number of procedures in appeal, there is one appeal, unless we talk about Article 136 SLP to the Supreme Court. As far as revision is concerned, there are provisions for preliminary and for final revisions. The type of examination, now that is again one of the crucial issues, which is a jurisdictional one. An appeal is on the basis of point of law and facts. As far as revision is concerned, it is on the basis of legal action, jurisdiction, and procedure, and therefore confined, as we said, restricted. Filing, is it necessary? Yes, in appeal, it is necessary to file. In revision, is it necessary? Well, it can be by filing, or it can be suo motu by the higher court having power of revision. No filing is compulsory. And I think these are some of the essential features that I thought would be of interest to us while dealing with this issue. Coming a little further, by what kind of powers can be exercised in revision? So as far as revision is concerned, I mentioned re-examination of legal actions. There may be some assumptions made illegally, non-exercise or exercise of jurisdiction irregularly by a lower court. The superior court can therefore decide to examine or not examine a decision made by a lower court. The primary purpose of a revision is to make sure that justice has been administered properly and to correct the errors which could have led to improper justice. We do remember at all times that criminal law itself involves the liberties and security of the people, and therefore it is essential to be able to examine the propriety of a judgment, not only on facts, but also on procedure, on substantive law, on questions of jurisdiction, on question of power exercise, and each of these features will lead to the divisional powers. Some of the directions that the Supreme Court has given in this case is to say that Supreme Court says the High Court and Sessions Court have supervisory jurisdiction, which give a very wide part of the divisional court to test the correctness, legality, or propriety of any finding, sentence, or order. Such a court may also interfere to examine the regularity of any proceedings.
Just to bother you, yes. The chart which you had said, we have already displayed on the board. You can, if you want to give a reference, for any reference, we have displayed it on the board. The team has done that work.
I'm grateful. I thought this would be of some help as an immediate ready reckoner.
Every word of yours is a pearl of wisdom. But just that...
I'm grateful. I feel, you know, ultimately you are here standing in front of all your colleagues and lending yourself to this exercise, which Vikas, you have very kindly set up. So the idea was to prosper for ourselves as much as for everybody else. But coming back on the question of this jurisdictional issues, I have already highlighted the differences between appeal and revision. And I think we've mentioned them, but very quickly, you have the legal positions, the legal provisions, which are outlined in the chart. You have the jurisdictions exercised by the court. You have the legal rights. I'll tell you the real issues, as I mentioned earlier. The legal rights, the power of interference, and the type of examination. I think these three are the critical areas which define the difference between appeal and revision. So if we proceed on that level, we would ultimately be able to go in the right direction. What are the powers the courts have, the High Court has in exercise of revision? I should have made a chart for that too, but I didn't get around to that. But let me just quickly outline that. There's a power to order retrial. For example, it was mentioned in Ayodhya Dubey versus Ram Sumer Singh, 81 Supreme Court, 1415. The power to order commitment or to set aside commitment. Power to direct further inquiry under Section 398. Power to allow composition. Power to order restoration of property. Power to consider case of non-appealing accused. Power to consider the case of non-applicant. Power to expunge remarks. Power to stay proceedings. Power to enhance sentence. The CRPC has not abolished the High Court's power of enhancement of sentence by exercising revisional jurisdiction suo motu. And therefore, you talk about each of these jurisdictions, and particularly Section 397, to say the correctness, legality, or propriety of any finding, sentence, or order. This, of course, is provided within the parameters of Section 397 itself. Coming to another issue of what is the position between a sessions judge exercise of divisional powers and High Court. As far as divisional jurisdiction is concerned, the main finding on this would be able to be set out in literally a sentence to say it is concurrent and coextensive. So therefore, you can file a revision in the sessions court, or you can file a revision before the High Court. They are invested with similar jurisdictions over subordinate criminal courts within their respective jurisdiction. However, if you have exercised jurisdiction by filing revision before the sessions judge, then you would be limited in not being able to file a second revision before the High Court, and that is prescribed within the parameters of the provisions of Section 397 itself, which bars. In fact, Section 397, I would at this point like to very basically discuss with you what 397 itself involves. Now, Section 397, where it says calling for the powers for records to exercise powers of revision. So firstly, the High Court or Sessions Judge may call for and examine the record of any proceeding before any inferior criminal court situated within its or his local jurisdiction for the purpose of satisfying itself or himself as to the correctness, legality, or propriety of any finding, sentence, or order recorded or passed, and as to the regularity of any proceedings of such inferior court, and may, when calling for such record, direct that the execution of any sentence or order be suspended, and if the accused is in confinement, that he be released on bail on his own bond pending the examination of the record. The limitations on revision, subsection 2. The powers of revision conferred by subsection 1 shall not be exercised in relation to any interlocutory order passed in any appeal, inquiry, trial, or other proceeding. As I had mentioned at the beginning, I will be coming to a little more detail on this aspect, because this has been the source of tremendous controversy from time to time. Everybody tries to understand what is an interlocutory order. Can you file a revision against an interlocutory order? Does subsection 397(2) itself completely bar, or is there any avenue? Indeed, there is, and I will come to that in a short period of time. Subsection 3 of Section 397, if an application under this section has been made by any person either to the High Court or to the Sessions Court judge, no further application by the same person shall be entertained by the other of them. So therefore, you have basically a situation where you cannot exercise further revisional powers, as I mentioned, after you have exercised the first revisional powers. With this in hand, let me stretch to the other direction of our source of dealing with this. And as I mentioned, in particular, interlocutory and intermediate orders. The expression now, which has become synonymous, so you have three different kinds of orders. You have a final order, you have an interlocutory order, and you have an intermediate order. So indeed, what you will find, and I will just discuss this very briefly with all of us, that we will come to a position where you will have revisions against what the court has laid down to be intermediate orders, and that is evolved over a period of time, and it stretches across Madhulime's judgment, it stretches across the field of Amarnath, it stretches across the field of V.C. Shukla, it stretches across, coming to finally to Girish Suneja, a three-judge bench, headed by Justice Madan Lokur. In fact, I was a party to that case, which ultimately, in the context of the 2G scam, held that there are three kinds of jurisdictions. So basically, a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court in Suneja, which is 2017, volume 14, SEC 809, reiterated the categorization of orders for the purpose of criminal revisional jurisdiction into interlocutory, intermediate, and final. While interlocutory orders are clearly out of the revisional jurisdictions, intermediate and final orders are not. An intermediate order is one which, although is not a final order, but if reversed, would bring the proceedings against the accused to an end. That is the test. bring the proceedings against the accused to an end. For example, an order for framing of charges is not a final order, but if reversed, then the proceedings would come to an end, and therefore it would have the effect of conclusively affecting the outcome of the proceedings. So you have to have an order which may not be a final order, but would bring the proceedings to an end. Another example is the order taking cognizance. If such order is set aside, then again the proceedings would come to an end. In contradistinction to the foregoing, is an order granting bail, which is an interim order of temporary nature and therefore not subject to revision. So an order granting bail is not revisable. In this case, which is the Girish-Suneja case, the court holds as follows. We also make it clear that any prayer, this is the order which was passed by the High Court, which is under consideration. We also make it clear that any prayer for stay or impeding the progress in the investigation, oblique trial can be made only before this court and no other court shall entertain the same. The bench held that the divisional jurisdiction of the High Court is a discretionary jurisdiction to be exercised in aid of justice. What is significant is that a litigant does not have a right to have a revisable order set aside. Whether the High Court chooses to exercise its revisional jurisdiction in a particular case or not depends on the facts of the case. Hence, the reference to the revisional jurisdiction as a discretionary jurisdiction. The revisional jurisdiction only conserves the power of the High Court to ensure that justice is done in accordance with the recognized rules of criminal jurisprudence and that criminal courts subordinate to the High Court do not exceed their jurisdiction or abuse the powers vested in them by the CRPC. In view of these conclusions of the Constitution Bench, there is no doubt that the appellants do not have any right to the division of a revisable order. Now, as I said, my intention of this particular portion, and I could have, and I will just point out to you, because all of you would be able to have reference to that. For this purpose, you should look at, as I mentioned, Amarnath, Madhulume, and B.C. Shukla, because each of these carries on to this direction. And therefore, to some extent, this may be considered a dilution of the statutory bar. On the other hand, the question is what was meant by interlocutory order and whether indeed, if there was an order which determined the proceedings yet not final, would you have no remedy in law? Therefore, this interpretation of final, interlocutory, and intermediate. And I think we must evolve the law in a clear direction in this case, so that we are able to judge for ourselves in which kind of cases we can come up for appeal. I say so because I know as a practicing lawyer, there were times and times, and those days, in fact, Amarnath used to be the guiding broad principle. And even Amarnath itself, which said that there is a bar against an interlocutory order, ultimately dealt with this issue. And even there it was recorded, and I'll just read out that portion to you because I know we kept looking for reasons of how we could ultimately go to exercise the divisional jurisdiction. And I will just point out to you what Amarnath said, which is, though at some points against filing a division against an interlocutory order, it also comes to the same principles. And those principles in Amarnath, which were mentioned, it says the following. Thus, for instance, orders summoning witnesses, adjourning cases, passing orders for bail, calling for reports and such other steps in aid of the pending proceedings may no doubt amount to interlocutory orders against which no division would lie under Section 397(2) of the 1973 Code. But, this is a significant part, but orders which are matters of moment and which affect or adjudicate the rights of the accused or a particular aspect of the trial cannot be said to be interlocutory order so as to be outside the purview of the divisional jurisdiction of the High Court. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is something that at least I personally remember referring to this part of Amarnath to say that something like intermediate, though that was not an expression we had coined by that time, but we said intermediate orders or orders of moment, we can file a division against that, and the statute does not bar jurisdiction against the same on the ground that there are interlocutory orders. Now, I would come to the next broad subject. And as I said, this is a completely vast field and vast arena. So definitely, I am unable to cover all possible aspects. So the third aspect that I thought I would discuss with all of you is the inherent powers of the court, High Court. Now, Section 482 CRPC, when a lawyer is going to file a revision, appeal, or rather a remedy to the higher court. The lawyer has to see for himself or herself as to what kind of remedy is available. So appeal is a defined remedy under Chapter 29 of CRPC, as we have said. Appeal is barred in some cases also. For example, in cases of plea bargaining, you have a bar under 265G of the CRPC, so you don't have an appeal. The other you have is a revision. And the third avenue that you would have is Section 482 CRPC, which is a non-obstantive clause. 482 itself allows it to be invoked, which is the inherent powers of the High Court. And can it be invoked? So there has been a lot of back and forth in this direction. And evaluation as far as 482 is concerned. I'm thankful to somebody who's actually put it out there for us. So you will have the duty of the saving of inherent powers of High Court. Nothing in this court shall be deemed to limit or affect the inherent powers of the High Court to make such orders as may be necessary to give effect to any order under this court or to prevent abuse of the process of any court or otherwise to secure the ends of justice. So what do you do, ladies and gentlemen, if you have, if you want to challenge any kind of investigation? What do you want to do and how do you want to approach the issues if you want to quash an FIR? What do you want to do if you have a criminal complaint which has been filed? What do you want to do if there is impropriety in the manner of handling the case by a lower court or in fact by any other agency? What do you want to do when you have issues of wanting special investigation? These are the instances where 482 steps in. And even though we have gone back and forth to some extent, as I said, on the jurisdiction, the final holding of the courts, by and large, has by now been very clearly that you can ultimately approach the High Court in its inherent jurisdiction in the case of any miscarriage of justice, and the bars of 397, the divisional bars, which are interlocutory orders, for example, which are the case of second revision, none of the bars of 397 of revision, etc., would apply to the High Court in exercise of its jurisdiction under Section 482 CRPC. I will just very quickly go through some of the judgments on this aspect of 482, and I think some of them, of course, the lead case is from Punjab and Haryana, which is the state of Haryana versus Bhajanlal principle and the landmark judgment in 1992, Supplementary 1, SCC 335, where the Supreme Court considered in detail the provisions of Section 482 and the power of the High Court to quash criminal proceedings or FIR. Most of you must be familiar with them.
Just wait for a minute. I would request someone should not scribble it on the screen whenever the sections, etc. are being displayed. That rather spoils the entire tempo. The entire team is trying to put an endeavor that all sections and judgments are posted on the chat box. Don't scribble if you don't want to be part of it. You can always leave the group rather than. I might look rude, but everybody is getting disturbed. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. You are right. Scribbling does mean sometimes you feel that no attention should be paid on that. At least as lawyers, that's what we do. When you don't want to read something, you strike it out. So you're right there. But coming back to state of Haryana versus Bhajanlal, I think the Supreme Court laid down essential guidelines, which till date, right from 1992 onwards, disclose the basis of the jurisdiction of the High Court in cases of quashing criminal proceedings or FIR. You are familiar with most of them, but maybe I'll request Vikas to just put out the final findings of state of Haryana versus Bhajanlal. But essentially, the principle of touchstone of testing whether indeed criminal proceedings or FIR should be quashed would be where the allegations made in the first information report or the complaint, even if they are taken at their face value and accepted in their entirety, do not prima facie constitute any offense or make out a case against the accused. And I think, I will tell all my friends that what we do when we are basically taking up Section 482 CRPC and the inherent powers of the court for quashing of proceedings, in this case, the fair thing would normally be to basically go through the FIR or ultimately, of course, the charge sheet. And if the FIR itself fits in as far as the facts are concerned, as disclosed by the complainant, if it fits in into the offense, then indeed there cannot be a case of quashing. But if the facts do not disclose any legal offense as prescribed under the IPC, in that eventuality, the FIR or the proceedings could be and are quashed. And in fact, courts today are taking up such cases from time to time and ensuring that there is no miscarriage of justice, because do remember that criminal trials take an immensely long time and in fact are a stigma on your life in various ways. They constrain you. You may be constrained from leaving the country. You may be constrained, even though these years in COVID-19, nobody's leaving the country or anywhere for that matter. But there could be constraints and restrictions on your movement or your liberties. So therefore, it is essential, in fact, that if there are proceedings which are a miscarriage of justice or are blatantly erroneous or incorrect or do not base themselves to an offense, in that case, such proceedings should be quashed.
And the relevant video of Bhajanlal has been posted on the group. And again, please do not scribble. Whatever has been posted, it means that is the relevant portion, please.
This is, in fact, Vikas has very kindly put out the 7 findings which Bhajanlal sets out. And it is good law till date and will continue to be good law because it essentially lays down the criteria for quashing. In 2017, in Parbati Ahir versus State of Gujarat, Supreme Court elaborated on the principles governing exercise of inherent powers under 482 CRPC. This was a 3-judge bench of Justice Deepak Mishra, Chief Justice, and Justice Khanwelkar and Justice Chandrachud, explaining the principles governing the inherent powers of the High Court under Section 482, while saying that inherent powers of the High Court has a wide ambit and plenitude. It has to be exercised to secure the ends of justice or to prevent an abuse of the process of court. And the court ultimately summarized again the principles on principles such as the following. The invocation of the jurisdiction of the High Court to quash a FIR or a criminal proceeding on the ground that a settlement has been arrived at between the offender and the victim is not the same as the invocation of jurisdiction for the purpose of compounding an offense. In the exercise of powers under Section 482, and while dealing with a plea that the dispute has been settled, the High Court must have due regard to the nature and gravity of the offense. Heinous and serious offenses involving mental depravity or offenses such as murder, rape, and dacoity cannot appropriately be quashed through the victim or the family of the victim have settled the dispute. This is on settlement. This is another area of great discussion, whether indeed there's a settlement between the parties. Can such proceedings be quashed? Because the law itself, criminal law, provides for compounding. But in addition to compounding, there are cases which are not compoundable. Can they be quashed? Has been a source of immense dispute, as you people know, probably more strongly in the family law field, where you have number of settlements which are happening all across the country. And I'm sure, of course, in Punjab and Haryana too. Distinguished from serious offenses, criminal cases which have an overwhelming or predominant element of a civil dispute, they stand on a distinct footing insofar as exercise of inherent power to quash is concerned. This is, again, an immense area of dispute, whether when you have a criminal dispute which has civil components to it, is the same to be quashed and to be dealt with under a civil remedy or criminal remedy. But I will leave this discussion to another day. Criminal cases involving offenses which arise from commercial, financial, mercantile, partnership or similar transactions with essentially civil flavor may in appropriate situations call for quashing where parties will settle the dispute. Such disputes possibly should be settled. Economic offenses involving financial and economic well-being of the state, implications which are way beyond a mere dispute between private disputants. So the principle of law, I know some of you must have done, and I have definitely done a number of cases where, for example, in cases of cheating, 420, in cases of bank frauds, in cases of institutional frauds, you've had settlement between the parties and the cases come up to the Supreme Court or the High Court for quashing. And the law on this, by and large, by the courts has been that simply because parties have settled, since it involves a public nature issue, should the same be quashed? Possibly not. And that has been the finding across board on cases of economic offences, particularly where they are very grievous and heinous and involve large scams. These have been particularly the issues. Again, the Supreme Court, while upholding at all times that there must be constant supervision in inherent powers, also says that quashing powers under Section 482 should not be exercised to stifle legitimate prosecution. So it should not be overwhelming. And in that, you will find in Chila Kamarthi, Venkatara Leshwaru, versus State of Andhra Pradesh, 2019 Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court held that High Court rightly refused to quash the criminal complaint, observing that it can exercise power under Section 482 of CRPC only in rare cases. The power to quash the proceedings is generally exercised when there is no material to proceed against the petitioners, even if the allegations in the complaint are prima facie accepted as true. This is Bhajanlal's principles again. The court, the High Court in effect found, and rightly, that the allegations in the complaint, coupled with the statements recorded by the learned magistrate, had the necessary ingredients under the various sections 307, 323 and others, which are mentioned in this. Finally, what I will come to is whether it can be invoked 482 if alternative remedy is available. And this, as I said, is an area of, has been an area which has been discussed by the Supreme Court from time to time, and there have been varying versions. So, for example, in Amarnath, which we have already quoted and cited to you earlier, it was held that it cannot be exercised, but then this position was subsequently reversed in Madhuleme and Raj Kapoor, both of which ultimately held that you can have the exercise of inherent powers despite availability of an alternate remedy. Again, there were two conflicting judgments after that, which is Dhariwal Tobacco and Mohit, alias Sonu. In Dhariwal, it was held that even if you had a remedy under 397 and 401, you could still invoke the inherent powers of the High Court under Section 482. But Mohit versus State of UP, it was held that that is not possible, and that is what led to some areas of dispute and discussion. But ultimately, the same were resolved in each of these directions. And the Supreme Court today has held, as held in Madhuleme and Shukla, V.C. Shukla, that you can invoke the inherent powers of the Supreme Court, of the High Court under Section 482, in cases with the, where there is abuse of process of law and miscarriage of justice. I am not able to trace the final judgment readily. It has somehow gone.
Can you just tell the caption? The team will post.
Yeah, so I'll come back to that later. But basically, the position is settled today in law that inherent powers of the court can be exercised even if there is an alternate remedy under Section 482 CRPC. So, Vikas, I don't know whether there are other aspects which we would like covered, but as I mentioned to you earlier, it is not fair nor possible to deal with each aspect of even, I thought this was comparatively possible, but then when I looked at it further, I realized that I had to limit myself to the three broad headings within this interplay between appeal, revision, and inherent powers, and some of the key areas, because as I said, what does a lawyer really look for? When can I file a remedy against an order passed by a subordinate court? And that, I think, is a key question that confronts lawyers, and that is the expertise which we require to develop, in particular in these fields, to see that indeed there are several provisions. The question is to find the right provision. The question is to define the contours of that jurisdiction. Because very often, if we file in the wrong forum or the wrong jurisdiction, we will be ousted and we'll deny ourselves. And one other principle I must share with you, Vikas, at this point, is that every lawyer and every litigant for that matter wants to ensure that they have all possible remedies. Now, whether it is by way of a first revision and thereafter also by way of inherent powers of the High Court, which of course is very limited in scope, but nobody, for example, will broadly file a revision in the High Court in the first instance. You will file a revision in this in the Sessions Court in the hope that in case you do not succeed, you will have another remedy subsequently. So these are the critical areas that we as lawyers need to constantly function, focus on. And in that manner, we can give the best kind of justice to an accused who, for that matter, even to the complainant, because the rule of law involves a greater determination of the points in dispute, the forum, the jurisdiction, the points of interference as far as higher courts are concerned. And of course, finally, you have the Supreme Court. And fortunately for us, now the Supreme Court has put to rest a number of the controversies. So we should try, in fact, to proceed on those levels rather than to reopen and regurgitate the same issues that have been settled. But for a true understanding, we should go through these particular points, because this is what really affects the criminal system at the greatest levels. Thank you.
Wonderful.
Can't hear you.
Ma'am, I said, yes. It was really a good experience for all of us. We had a bird eye view of everything. In 40 minutes, it was just like six sixes of Yuvraj. We all thoroughly enjoyed. There couldn't have been a better session than that. And as you said, that there are a few aspects which you could not have dealt from. As a lawyer, one should always have the knowledge that what the viewer or what the judge wants. We have learned that you are still keen to teach us more, guide us more. So one is, Atithi tum kab jaoge? We say, Atithi tum bas yahi raho aur hum sunte rahe. We'll hear you the next time again. So ma'am, on to the Q&A sessions. We are taking one by one. From Amnish, it's under section 378, appeal in case of acquittal. As per recent judgment, a victim need not make an application taking special leave to appeal from an order of acquittal, and can file an appeal in High Court against the order of acquittal in complaint case. Please clarify.
Well, as I said, in criminal jurisprudence, there is a number of discussions at point, and generally speaking, a victim, there has been issues on this court, whether a victim can file a special leave to appeal only or file an appeal. But the latest judgment seems to have held that you can file an appeal to the High Court. So therefore, we will have to evaluate the situation further.
One is asking, what is the difference between interlocutory and intermediate order?
As I mentioned to you, this is one of the key areas of dispute, because for the reason that 397 subsection 2 bars a revision against an interlocutory order. But by and large, for example, interlocutory order would be an order issuing, for example, any directions, ordering any kind of investigation. The principle which is decided, which has to be looked at, in fact, is this. An intermediate order, as opposed to an interlocutory order, is one which decides the issue. For example, an order closing evidence. That would ultimately decide the issue. For example, an order of framing charge. Now, that would ultimately decide the issue. An order discharging an accused at the stage of charge. That would also decide the issue. So, a situation which terminates the proceedings, such an order is known as an intermediate order, which is revisable under 397. Any such order which is purely passed during the course of hearing, which doesn't terminate the proceedings, is an interlocutory order. And the principle is actually behind this, that a trial should be allowed to go its finality and conclude, and an appeal be filed against the final sentence, and not to have interventions at stages which are interlocutory or interim in nature. That is the entire principle of interlocutory and intermediate orders.
Jay Singh asks, once a conviction under section 304A, IPC has been upheld in an appeal at the Sessions Court. Which is the next remedy? Is it 397 read with 401 or is it 482 CRPC?
As I said, 397 itself bars a second revision. So you have a complete bar to filing a second revision once you have filed the first revision. However, the inherent powers of the court under 482 save the exercise of jurisdiction in cases of gross abuse of law, miscarriage of justice, jurisdictional errors. And therefore, and also because 482 is a non-substantive provision, so therefore the exercise as far as after the first appeal is concerned would be to proceed by way of 482 CRPC in the inherent powers of the High Court.
Then Sushank asks, what remedy would lie when a JMIC has dismissed a private complaint after considering the preliminary evidence, as it is neither an order of acquittal nor discharge?
A GMC order which is neither an acquittal nor, you said, a charge.
No, I will just read the question. He says that this private complaint has been dismissed after considering the preliminary evidence. As it is neither an order or discharge, what is the remedy?
It is not a discharge, but it is a dismissal of a complaint. So it becomes a final order and therefore it would be appealable.
Is summoning order revisable or quashable, especially in the light of full use of the Honorable Apex Court that in spite of alternative remedy, you can invoke 482 CRPC?
This is an area which is somewhat gray. An order of summons basically has been held to be revisable. At the same time, courts have interfered in inherent jurisdiction under 482. But essentially, an order summoning an accused is an order which is considered to be, let me put it like this, an intermediate order. So therefore, revision is available. But there are cases you will find during the course of examination that 482 is exercised even where a revision is available, but revision is not utilized. So therefore, it would be a case where you don't go to revision, you can still go to 482 and the High Court would look at it in an appropriate case.
Then Harpreet Kaur asks, if the interlocutory order is passed by a court without jurisdiction, even then bar of section 397 subclause 2 will apply?
Yes, it will. Because the principle is that it is being passed without jurisdiction, and that is what 482 and for that matter Article 227, I didn't go into that area today, but you would have the jurisdiction of the High Court under 482 as well as power of superintendence under 227 when such jurisdiction has been exercised, which either the court didn't have or wrongly exercised the jurisdiction.
Ma'am, Seema Sani asks, can a revision be filed on an order of process issued after a plea is recording on, or inherent powers have to be used?
A pre-recording guilty, did you say?
A revision can be filed, where it should have been, whether a revision can be filed on an order of process issued after plea is recording.
No, it isn't, because in such a case, the appeal is provided. In a case where plea is recorded, I think an appeal is barred. In case of pre-bargaining, as I mentioned to you, 265, in specific terms, it is barred under 265G, which is a separate chapter altogether. And even where a plea is, made and the order is passed thereafter, the same is non-appealable. And therefore, the same could be revisable, but not appealable.
Then Deepak Verma asks, even there are some discrepancies regarding stage of availing Section 482, for instance, before framing of the charge, before trial proceeds, etc., etc. Kindly throw some light on that.
No, you are right. In fact, you will find that when you discuss, you see, Bhajan Lal's principles, the whole basis is not only the FIR, it is any criminal proceeding, any stage. In fact, this is another area which is a very wide area, that 482 can be invoked at any stage, even prior to the framing of charge, even prior to, even at the time of the criminal complaint itself. So you have cases where you are seeking quashing of the criminal complaint for being an abuse of the process, and that is even before any process itself has actively started. So availability of 482 is very wide and can be utilized at any stage, starting from the initiation of the criminal proceedings. And that I will not go into initiation, because initiation itself is an area of a cognizance. When is cognizance taken? So I'm not saying cognizance, I am saying initiation. It could be at the very outset that you can invoke 482 CRPC.
And we have already got 25 messages in the box.
Can't hear you.
Yes. Can the matter be remanded back by the appellate court for retrial to bring on record a new evidence to explore the alternative angle?
Always. It can be. There's always a power of an appellate court to order fresh investigation, further investigation, and such powers are exercised subject to correction 378 of CRPC. You have the powers to do such processes, and you find such a process happening, because you cannot, it's not retrial, but further evidence comes to light, it can be taken into account, and it has been taken into account in some proceedings in the Supreme Court also, where fresh evidence comes, what to what level it is taken note of, and what kind of further modifications of the orders are called, is yet another matter. But reinvestigation and is definitely a portion which is specifically contemplated in the CRPC.
Then, when proceedings are dropped by the JMIC in a summons case, prior to framing of charge, whether it amounts to acquittal or discharge, what remedy would lie against that order?
Where the proceedings, it will not amount to acquittal or discharge for that matter, because the proceedings are dropped prior to all this stage. So technically, it would not amount to discharge, but dropping of the proceedings itself doesn't seem to be providing, there's no appeal against that. So it would ultimately be divisible at the instance of the party which wants to seek a remedy.
One question, friend of ours has posted a question. He says, nowadays, district courts do not call the records. Any ruling later is that record be called as lower court does not stop further proceeding. Thus, revision file becomes infructuous. That could be
Well, let me tell you the practical part first. All of us traditionally, when we file revisions or appeals, we presume that the lower court proceedings came to be stayed. And nothing further would be proceeded in them. But as a matter of course, that is not so. Calling for the records doesn't automatically amount to stay. Courts in their discretion, in their wisdom, and in order to have propriety at times, would not proceed further in the case because a higher court has called for the file. But technically, simply because certain jurisdiction is being exercised by a higher court, whether divisional or appellate, doesn't automatically amount to a stay of the lower court proceedings.
Gagandeep Goyals asks, can public police investigation be stayed when police has started investigation but charge sheet has not been filed? Courts generally don't interfere till charge sheets.
You are absolutely right, Vikas. The question asked by Gagandeep is very appropriate because the whole principle is that investigation should not be stopped unless and until there are now cases because you find that there is some fabricated kind of investigation going on, some investigation by agency which is not doing an appropriate investigation. You want another agency to do the investigation. So definitely, though there are limitations circumscribed on interference in respect of investigation and by and large courts would not do it, but in extreme cases where there is manifest illegality or miscarriage of justice, for example, there is frivolous litigation and investigation is going on and the court finds that the FIR doesn't disclose, for example, any kind of case against the accused or the complaint doesn't disclose or it's a motivated complaint or it's a vexatious complaint. The court can possibly interfere in the investigation, but I repeat that it is only in exceptional cases.
Ma'am, we would be having time because some of them were just thanking. So I thought there were a lot of questions. Few questions can still be asked. Anurag then asked if revision has been, KPS Works asked, if an accused is acquitted in a trial by a court of magistrate, but the revision and adequate, is revision the adequate remedy or 482 CRPC?
Against an acquittal, you basically have an appeal provided for. So normally an appeal would be filed against that. Revision, as I mentioned to you, in cases where appeal is provided for, you cannot file revision.
Can we file the quashing under 226 or 482? What is your take on that?
That is basically an area which I think is somewhat intermingling with each other, and there are appropriate cases which fall in either of the two categories. It is difficult to kind of categorize the jurisdiction under 482 and Article 226, but by and large, you have 226 is there, the 227, so your supervisory jurisdiction. At the same time, you have 482, which has inherent powers of the High Court. And both deal with abuse of the process of law, miscarriage of justice, excess exercise of jurisdiction. But more or less cases where there is excess exercise of jurisdiction or complete lack of jurisdiction or wrong exercise of jurisdiction, that 226 and 227 would lie rather than 482.
Ujjwal Jain asks, what remedy lies when the application of person seeking further investigation has been censured by the magistrate court?
I'm sorry, sinister is not the right word, I think. So, it must be something else.
Then he has clarified, dismissed.
Oh, dismissed. When the application of a person seeking further investigation has been dismissed by the magistrate court. This possibly would fall in the category of intermediate orders because it would and could possibly put an end to the, as they say, matters of moment, or put an end to the trial. So it could fall in the intermediate category, but in case it doesn't put an end to the proceeding, that is one of the tests ultimately, that intermediate orders would be such that would one way or the other put an end to the proceeding. So if indeed such a issue of further investigation doesn't put an end to the proceedings, let me put a case to you, for example, facts of a case. So supposing you, in a particular case, the investigation has not found that the accused has committed an offense, let's say under section 302. Now, further investigation has been called for, but in the meantime, without that further investigation, the person would be acquitted. Now, in such a case, it would be possibly an intermediate order. But in a case where, for example, you do have disclosure on offense, but certain further investigation would either substantiate or corroborate that position, then it might fall in the category of interlocutory order, because it would not decide the issue. It is only a step in aid of a criminal process which is ongoing. So therefore, in that case, it may not be revisable, but then you could choose to exercise the power under 482 CRPC.
Mr. Hemant asks, in case of denial of an early hearing by a magistrate in the complaint case, whether 482 would be maintainable or a revision would be maintained in the sessions court?
Denial of an early hearing definitely is an interlocutory order. So you could only possibly go by way of 482 or even 226 of the Constitution.
Then Amarjeet Wells asks, if an accused is acquitted in a magistrate trial, but convicted in an appeal by a court of sessions, whether accused should file appeal or a revision?
No, but you basically have, you cannot file a revision where an appeal lies. That is a principle of law. So therefore, it cannot be against that order. At most, you could go in proceedings under 482 or ultimately to by way of an SLP to the Supreme Court, but you couldn't have a revision after an appeal.
Okay. Can High Court stay coercive action against the accused in quashing of FIR when his anticipatory bail has been dismissed?
His anticipatory bail has been dismissed. In that case, coercive action, definitely the High Court can order for arrest of the person. It is an anticipatory bail. He's not got the anticipatory bail. The orders and directions can be given to agencies. Orders can be given for arrest. And further, any orders in aid of that process may also be done.
Mr. Bhrigu Sharma asks, what is the stage when CBI investigation can be demanded? Whether
at any stage?
Or after the charge sheet?
Or
after the filing of the charge sheet?
CBI investigation can be called at any stage. It is limited, and you have to, normally, as you know, that CBI investigation would be ordered by the High Court under 226 or Article 32 of the Constitution. But CBI investigation can be done at any stage. The idea is that appropriate investigation is not being done, so you need another investigative agency. And normally, of course, the credibility of the organization is the one which is discussed and highlighted and therefore sought. That can be ordered at any stage. There is no stage at which a CBI can be called for.
Thank you. Dheeraj's question is, whether a revision petition when the revision petition is decided by the Sessions Court and the order is challenged under 482, court generally observes regarding the maintainability. What is your take on that?
You're talking about an order which is... Sorry, I'm sorry. You'll have to repeat that, Vikas.
Meanwhile, I will read. Ashwinder Kaur says, does the order of interim maintenance fall in the category of intermediate order? For quashing of such an order, is the revision an adequate remedy or 482?
Interim order, interim maintenance is a very questionable area for the reason that it is an order which decides the rights of parties. And that, if you look at even Amarnath and orders of movement. So to that extent, you could say that an interim order is also a final order up to that time that the final maintenance is decided. So it could be considered an intermediate order. I would not be able to give a final answer on this, but as I dare say that it could be considered as an intermediate order. However, we will leave it for the time being for the courts to take a final call on that. In any case, if it is not possible to go in revision, you can go in 482 and would be able to get a remedy in that direction.
What locus an accused has to impugn a complaint before the issuance of the summoning order?
You impugn a complaint, you seek for quashing of the complaint. That would always be by the accused. So it would always be when you find such cases which are asking for quashing of the complaint. And then incidentally, as far as I have seen in practice, and I'm sure all of you have seen the same in practice, that a number of accused go for quashing of the complaint. Whether ultimately it is quashed or not is based upon the parameters as we have discussed. But it is available as a remedy to the accused. If it is frivolous, it is vexatious, it doesn't disclose the cause of action, the Bhajandal principles. A complaint can be quashed at the instance of an accused.
If somebody's question has been missed out, you can repeat it in the chat box again. Supplementary question is by Bregu.
If a special legislation overrides CRPC, this it's an interesting question. Because normally the sections 4 and 5 of the CRPC allow CRPC to prevail unless it is specifically...
Ma'am, I will read the question because you have read it, the participants are not knowing. If a special legislation overrides CRPC, are inherent powers still recognized under section 482?
CRPC itself normally prevails even when there is a special law unless special law specifically overrides the CRPC. But if the CRPC ultimately is overridden, this would be a highly disputed area whether 482 itself would be available as a remedy. At the same time, if you take 482, nothing, it's a non-obstantive clause, nothing contained in the code. So therefore, it could possibly be exercised even when CRPC is overridden by a special law.
Then can a tribunal like NGT take suo motu cognizance of cases by invoking 482 CRPC?
Well, the question is 482 cannot be invoked by NGT, but suo motu cognizance can be taken and is taken from time to time. However, not the criminal proceedings or the criminal procedure code in any manner.
Then what is the scope and settled position in respect of petitions under 482 for an accused who haven't faced trials, being absconded and other have been acquitted by the trial court? As sometimes High Court says, supplementary chalan may have something against you.
Of course, I mean, you're right, but this would obviously depend on the facts of the case. We do know that in a number of cases, you don't have a single charge sheet or a chalan, as it is called, or a final report. Incidentally, we again in criminal law have various manners of description of 173 reports. So simply because the person's name doesn't figure in the charge sheet or the final report, in that case, it doesn't mean that the accused can actually be discharged or in any manner let off from the trial, because there's always a possibility of a supplementary charge sheet coming up. So, and particularly if you're absconding, now I don't know the context of absconding, because you would abscond only when there was a case against you. You would technically be absconding if there is no case against you at that point of time. But on a broad principle, you do know that absconders are not entertained by the courts. The first principle of criminal jurisprudence is that a person who is seeking the course of justice should be there before the court. So you can't abscond. So normally, for example, if warrants are issued against an absconder or proclaimed offender proceedings under Section 82 of CRPC, etc., are initiated against the accused, then the first principle is that the accused has to come and get himself discharged of those provisions before the court will take up the hearing of the matter.
Mm-hmm. By Rajiv Joshi. Rajiv, can you pose the question again? Joshi? Does the order of interim maintenance fall in the category of intermediate order for quashing of such an order? Is revision or an adequate remedy or not?
I would say that interim maintenance order is final in nature to the extent of the interim situation, and therefore would be considered an intermediate order and therefore revisable.
Please discuss about the time limitation of filing of the appeal and revisions, including its exceptions.
I think we'll have to now more or less call it a day, and this could be another chapter altogether. So if you don't mind, So I have some other
comments. No, I understand.
Yeah.
I understand. It's all pleasure is all ours hearing you, despite the fact that it was a hectic schedule. Yet you have
but
been able
to. I must say here that I've enjoyed every bit of it. And treat it as not only as teaching, but as also learning. And the interactive process, I think the virtual world is yet to come alive. It is interesting to deal with people and to try to appreciate what their sources of concern are. And in that process, enlightening yourself even more. So thank you. And I've enjoyed particularly all your proverbs that you, during the course of conversation and interaction with me, were able to evolve for every appropriate moment. No,
We only evolve once we are involved with you. That
thank you, Vikas. I can't hear you. But I hope you can. So everybody, thank you so much and look forward to meeting you again soon. Good luck to Punjab and Haryana and all the lawyers across the country and to this particular process which has been set up by Beyond CLC, Beyond Law CLC as we call it. Thank you very much.